Welcome to Romania, Vice President Dombrovskis. First of all, I would like to ask you, how do you see the situation in Greece, the main topic in the European Union right now? What risks do you see and what solutions do you foresee for Greece's situation?
As you know, in the end of February, Eurogroup reached an agreement to extend the Greek bailout program by another 4 months. And right now, we are in technical negotiations with Greek governments as regards completion of the program review. Mm-hmm. And this requires successful implementation of the program conditionality. So, according to the Eurogroup decision, we have time for those technical discussions till end of this month. From European Commission side, I must say we are ready to accelerate the negotiations if it is needed. But in order for this current bailout program to succeed, it's important that all sides, including Greece, stick with their commitments.
What about Romania? It seems like some Euro area members look for an exit, but Romania keeps its track to Eurozone. Is 2019 a feasible objective? Romania postponed the objectives twice already.
First of all, as regards member states, I must say that also in case of Greece, European Commission is clearly working based on scenarios that Greece stays in euro area. And also, if you look at the public opinion, Greece, some 85% of Greeks actually support Greece staying in euro area. So just a small clarification. As regards Romania, certainly I welcome Romania's intention to join euro area. Of course, it requires very serious effort in terms of real convergence and possibility to deal with internal and external economic shocks. And I believe euro area member states are going to look very closely at this, given the recent negative experience with Eurozone crisis and with number of euro area countries ending up in a bailout programs. There are important procedural steps to be made. And first important procedural step is joining exchange rate mechanism 2, which in case of Romania means also major monetary policy change. You need then to abolish your floating or manage float exchange rate to a fixed exchange rate, and so basically fix your currency vis-a-vis euro, and then ensure both real and nominal convergence. And under, so to say, the quickest scenario, it takes at least 3 years between country joins exchange rate mechanism 2 and between country can join euro area, provided that all master criteria are being met. So now to discuss any specific euro introduction target date, first you need to discuss joining the ERM2 target yes. date, and then to build from there.
So to sum up, 2019 is a feasible objective?
As I was saying, if you need to, under the quickest possible scenario, at least 3 years between joining ERM2 actually joining euro area, it means that you normally should be in ERM2 already as of January 1st next year, the latest. Well, this currently seems quite challenging as a timetable, but as I said, first it's really to set the target date for joining the ERM2. and on parallel working on those issues of real convergence, structural reforms, because this is going to be important argument as regards other EU area member states. But just to finish on this, generally speaking, I would say it certainly provides a very good policy guidelines, some structural reforms guideline if you are setting this goal and working towards it.
Romania has a low deficit and a low public debt. A lower and lower inflation, prices are quite stable, stable is the currency too. It seems that we fulfill the basic criteria, Maastricht criteria, but still the Romanian people are the second, maybe the poorest in the EU. What would be the result of the for the common people in Romania after the EU accession?
Certainly as regards euro introduction, those results are largely determined by the real convergence of the economy. And this is a lesson we learned, including other things, during the euro area crisis. So in order to be successful in euro area, you really need to have a robust economy which can extend economic shocks with a fixed exchange rate or indeed with a euro, without the possibility to use exchange rate flotation as a monetary policy tool. But certainly there are a number of tangible benefits for member states joining the euro area in terms of deeper integration in European economy, in terms of foreign trade, in terms of possibility for attracting foreign investments, and also in everyday lives, in terms of practicalities, no need to exchange currencies, to have several bank accounts in national currency, in euros, and so on and so on.
You've been the Prime Minister of Latvia for 4 years. What happened in your country when you got in the Eurozone in 2014? What happened to the common people? Was there any shock, or was there any problem with the day-by-day life of the people?
Well, I would say that euro introduction in Latvia went very well, and also people have appreciated euro introduction. If you look, for example, at the support for euro in Latvia, when we were starting those discussions, according to the Eurobarometer data, there may be some 43% of the people in favor of euro. When we were just about to join in December 2013, there was already some 53% of the people in favor of euro. Now it's 74. So really you see that people have appreciated, and there have been some studies made. So what is people's perception? The first is really those practical benefits people feel in everyday life. Also the perception that this is helping to deeper integrate the European economy. There are inevitably right now also some geopolitical considerations, especially in Baltic states, that deeper integration in the Western structures vis-a-vis developments what we see in Eastern Partnership. Also there were lots of worries prior to the euro introduction that this will significantly raise prices, but this also was not the case. Indeed, what Eurozone countries, including Latvia, are worrying right now is of actually having too low of inflation, because we know that Eurozone inflation is substantially below ECB's target of inflation, yeah. Close to, but below 2%.
Mr. Dombrovskis, you've been the Prime Minister of Latvia for 4 years. It seems that we live in a tough neighborhood here in the eastern flank of the EU. Please tell us about your country. Does it feel a specific pressure from Russia? Well, what kind of pressure? Political pressure, propaganda pressure, a military one on your country?
Certainly there are lots of concerns in Latvia, also in other EU also in other Baltic states as regards Russia, as regards developments in Ukraine. It must be noted that Ukraine is not the first country which is facing Russia's aggression. Previously it was Georgia. So there are concerns. First and foremost, it is seen as a security issue to be dealt with in a framework of NATO. What is reassuring right now is that there is increased presence of NATO troops in Latvia and other Baltic states. There is increased cooperation in the framework of NATO as regards defense of the Baltic states. Also there are other challenges, including Russia's propaganda, not only in Baltic states, but I must say also in quite a few other EU member states.
Like, for example?
Primarily it's in Central and Eastern European countries, but not limited to that. We know that there are several very active English-speaking Russian propaganda services and so on. So there are a number of concerns, and it's very important that actually EU stays united in its response to this behavior, in its response to Russia's aggression against Ukraine, in imposing sanctions, if needed, prolonging sanctions, and actually really making it very clear to Russia that that kind of behavior is unacceptable in 21st century Europe.
Yes. Returning to Romania, we still have an assistance program with the EC and the IMF. Do we still need a new one after September as far as you assess the current structural reforms in Romania?
Actually we see that Romania is now transiting from its macroeconomic surveillance in context of balance of payments program to the normal macroeconomic surveillance in a context of European semester. And this year was the first year when we did a normal European semester assessment, including in-depth review as regards macroeconomic imbalances. We expect this balance of payments assistance program to be finished in September this year, and currently we're not discussing any follow-up arrangements. We expect that Romania is ready to move to the normal macroeconomic surveillance, but there are two important observations. First, it certainly would be helpful to actually successfully complete the current program with a review and not to just let it expire, because successfully completing the program will give additional reassurances also to the markets and would potentially improve the conditions of Romania's debt servicing, and it's important not to undo the steps which had been taken structural reforms and also fiscal effort. In this sense, European Commission has certain concerns as regards the new fiscal code and plans to reduce VAT, because according to European Commission's and also IMF assessments, they are going to have a sizable negative fiscal effect.
So actually, what are, more concrete, what are your concerns regarding the negative effects? What kind of negative effects? You are talking just about a gap in the budget, or you foresee something really negative with the whole economy of Romania?
Certainly economic performance is also linked with a financial stability. So it's important that financial stability and public finance sustainability is being preserved. That's our primarily concern. Actually, I had been raising this issue during the discussions with both Parliament and government, including Prime Minister Ponta.
So, did the Prime Minister convince you about the sustainability of the lowering of the VAT or not?
As I said, currently we are having some concerns, but we'll continue actually to work on this with Romanian authorities and try to find the best way forward.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.